The people who are trafficked are reusable. It's not like drugs or weapons. And this is something very common. It's not my own original idea. This is something that people in the field understand, that it is so lucrative because the person is reusable. They can work for this person. The death trafficker can put her with somebody else. She can work for that person and make the same amount of money probably for many years. So it is a large problem, especially in New York City, and we all have a lot of clients who have been in these situations. So another type of trafficking would be a larger network, which could also start with a relationship, a boyfriend-husband type relationship, but maybe when the person gets here, she's forced to work in this restaurant, and then they put her somewhere else and she's working in that restaurant, and then maybe now she's working in a massage parlor, and in the end maybe she's in prostitution. So there are larger networks and then there are smaller networks where maybe the woman comes here and works just with a few people. So it depends on the type of case. And again, those are just broad examples, and there are many different types of cases that we see. So red flags for if you are talking to somebody and you believe they may be trafficked, I'm going to tell you a few different things you could look for to maybe identify somebody. So if you see somebody who has evidence or who is showing evidence that they are under some type of control, so there have been threats to her family or to herself, or she's terrified of something. Someone took away the person's documents. So do you have a passport? I don't know. No. Yes. You can't see it. That's a red flag. It doesn't mean someone's trafficked, but it's an indicator that maybe something has gone on. Somebody who has skewed beliefs about law enforcement or the police, like if I go in the sub, I can't take the subway, it's very dangerous. So something like, I can't go to the hospital because I don't have papers and I'll get deported. Beliefs that you know aren't true, but you wonder where the person got these ideas. It doesn't mean they're trafficked, but it's a good indicator that maybe there's something more going on, because traffickers often have a lot of control and influence and give misinformation about systems and laws in the U.S. And another red flag, a major thing that you should look for, is somebody who gives you a canned story. So a story that seems too smooth for the way that they're presenting, or you feel like something is off about it, or you feel like it's just not true and you don't understand why, or it seems like there are certain things that don't connect or don't make sense. Those are indicators that the person is trafficked. Very often traffickers will give a whole story. If somebody arrests you, say this. At the hospital, tell the social worker that. And the stories often are, I've been doing this work for many years, or I have never done sexual work, I don't know what you're talking about, but they have 25 arrests. So things like really smooth, canned stories, that's something where you might hesitate and think maybe there's something else going on here. So what should you do? You should probably make a referral to a trafficking service provider agency. So any of us, there are several others, Safe Horizon, or there are several other agencies that do trafficking programs, but who can do a deeper assessment and give the clients the services that they need. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about tips for working with someone who you believe may be trafficked or who may be a survivor of a related type of trauma, because it is a little bit specific, the way that the interaction could go if you want to be successful in identifying this person or reaching them in some way. So we're all integral in identifying trafficked people because they are everywhere. And oftentimes, if there's such high levels of isolation that one service provider may be the only interface they're going to have for a long time and the only chance of getting help that they probably need. So it is important to interact in a way that you make the interaction count. You make a connection with the person in a way that they will feel comfortable. So I'm going to give you some tips for things that we found that help with that. For example, this is about health here. So if you have a client or you believe might need health services, and they've been trafficked into prostitution, a lot of times people are going to feel very uncomfortable to go seek those health services because they're going to have to do things like tell people how many partners they've had, or if they're transgender, they might have to answer questions about that. They just don't feel comfortable answering. So it's important to think about those things when you make referrals or when you provide these types of services, that those could be loaded questions. Maybe it's something routine for you to ask, but those could be very loaded questions for somebody who's been in this situation, and especially if it was not by their choice. They were trafficked or forced into it. So how can you do that? You can facilitate open questions, and don't be too afraid around loaded issues, because every issue with sexual labor and money and things, those are going to be loaded. Race, cultures, different, it's all loaded. You can't really avoid it. So what we try to do is, yeah, try to be politically incorrect. I'm not telling you go offend all your patients and your clients, but certain times you need to be willing to hear where the client is coming from, and maybe they use a term you're not comfortable with or that you wouldn't use, and it doesn't mean you have to reflect those terms, but it's okay if you misidentify somebody's gender, for example. It happened to me. Somebody came in, looked like what I thought was a man, gave me a male name. I asked gender, he said female. I said, oh, okay. Now, had I gone, yes, and just written it down without looking, you know, anything, that's one approach, but I would say it was better that I said, oh, okay, and smiled and said, is there another name you prefer? Because that gave the person a chance to try it out in a safe environment and said, oh, actually, I've just decided to transition to female and I just wanted to see how it would go. So had I not reacted, it may have not opened the door for the person to discuss it with me, and we ended up having a whole session about what it means to become transgender later in life. So that's just an example of how it is important to, had I been too afraid of offending the person, I wouldn't have been able to open that door with the client. And it's okay to be wrong, but I'm sorry, I messed up. I'm glad you told me. I'm glad you corrected it. And which would you prefer, he or she? Some other tips are cultural competence. It's okay to generalize if you think it's going to be helpful. For example, with a lot of our East Asian clients, if we say, if you've been in prostitution and you've done this and that, they'll get offended. So it's sometimes easier to say with any client, but especially we've noticed, and even our coworkers have noticed, that it's sometimes easier to say, if you know somebody who has been in this type of line of work, there are these services available. So it's a limiting of how many questions you're asking and a limiting of your projection of your idea of this person's culture, but it's also using the generalization that in the past I've offended someone by saying if you were in prostitution, so I'm going to try to avoid that. So another tip would be along those lines to try not to ask too many questions. Try to say, I wonder how it would be if blah, 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 or I wonder if you know somebody who may be able to use these services, because if this or this happened, we have these services available. Or how am I doing on time? Is there a timer, or I don't want to go over. Yeah? Oh, you're right there. Okay, thank you. So I'm almost done anyway. So it does help to say, you know, not everyone has experienced this, but if you have, we know people who have been in this situation and we could help. We would offer these services. For example, maybe you can let somebody know, and if you suspect that person might be in that situation. Another thing is mirror how feelings should be. So somebody will come in and maybe they'll be really point blank about the trauma. This and this and this and this happened, but they're not showing you emotion. And it's kind of, as a professional, tempting to just not react because you think that's professional. But a lot of times what the person is looking for is a reaction. Oh my goodness, that is horrible. I'm so sorry that happened to you. That's like a well-placed mirroring of an emotion that may help the client feel validated and feel like, it's okay, this person might understand me, instead of, and then the person's like, well, do they not hear? Do they not understand what I just said? Or should I continue? Or is that too much information? So, and finally, don't allow what we call flooding. So if the person does, for some reason, open a door and they start telling you everything, if you want the person to come back or you want to continue, it can be very helpful to stop and say, look, that I think we should take a break. This is a lot of information. That's a lot of things that have gone wrong in your life and a lot of trauma. And, you know, someone who suffered just one of those things might be in therapy a long time. You must be a very strong person. But I think we should stop and we can pick up there next time if you have another interaction with the person. Or that might be better for you to share with a counselor. I have a really good referral for you. And you can continue that conversation. I don't want to, you know, violate your privacy. It's okay to say stuff like that. And that may help because sometimes if the person has said too much, it's traumatizing to the person and to the worker. And they may not feel comfortable talking again. They might feel really like, oh, I bared everything and I'm so mortified and I'm just never going to talk about that again. And you may have missed an opportunity to help that person connect with somebody. So those are basics. The last thing is don't expect always the person to see themselves as a victim. A lot of times we've had clients who have gone through the whole process. They have even gotten an immigration remedy for this, which I think they're going to talk more about, stuff that's available to our clients, and they still don't think they were trafficked. So your terms don't even, sometimes it doesn't even apply to the client. You know they qualify for this service. You know they're a victim. You've helped them in this or that way. But sometimes, I mean, I've had a client come to me after 5 years in therapy and say, you know, I heard this woman, she got forced into this, and it was just a little different than my client's story, than the one who was telling me the story. And she said, and there's this thing called human trafficking, and it happened to her. I saw it on the news. And she's sitting there who was trafficked, who has her visa because she was trafficked, and just, we never used the term because she wasn't comfortable seeing herself as a victim. So there's a lot of different techniques for connecting with somebody, and those are just a few to keep in mind. So thank you so much.
Hi, my name is Sana. I'm from Sanctuary for Families. I'm at the Anti-Trafficking Initiative. We provide the pretty much exactly the same services. I think the only difference is that we don't provide services for sex workers, and most of our work is with international trafficking victims. I'd say about 80% of our clients are Spanish-speaking, and then the other one are majority Korean and Mandarin. And of course, there's some overlap in that because there's a province in China where they're ethnically Korean. So there's some overlap in that. But so I'm going to actually focus more, because this is a health symposium, on the health consequences of that trafficking victims experience, and maybe some challenges and barriers in addressing those health consequences. And my focus is actually also on reproductive health. So I'm going to be focusing a little bit more on that and mental health. In terms of general health, it's what you would expect. A lot of these women, when they're in captivity, a lot of, you know, one of the control tactics is beating. And so most of our clients do, a lot of them get broken in at first, but, you know, as you would assume, these women aren't just sitting there waiting for things to happen to them. A lot of them do try to get out of the situation. Of course, it depends on the person. But they have bruises, scars, and a lot of signs of torture. For sex trafficking victims, the traffickers are pretty smart about it, so a lot of the times you won't be able to see it visibly. Of course, you wouldn't want their face ruined. You wouldn't want any of their genitals or any of the sexual organs damaged, because that would be bad for their business. And of course, there's a general health issue. It depends on what country they come from, but depending on their country of origin and the GDP of that country, a lot of them, of course, have never received healthcare in the first place. So they'll be suffering from any kind of chronic, you know, anything that hasn't been detected. They've never been to the doctor. They've never had OB-GYN care, et cetera, et cetera. In terms of reproductive health, of course, STDs is a huge issue. Fortunately, with the clients that I've seen during my short 8 month career at Sanctuary, I haven't seen HIV/AIDS from the trafficking. We do have HIV positive clients, but it wasn't from the trafficking. But STDs is definitely a huge issue, and of course, because herpes is one of the major viral ones, that's the one that's difficult to deal with because it's not treatable, and it's ongoing care that's needed. And then of course, a lot of our clients complain a lot about pelvic pain, breast pain, rectal trauma, and urinary difficulties, problems urinating. There have been pregnancies resulting from rape or prostitution. I think it's really hard when a lot of our clients do have children, either from their trafficker, who they also consider their boyfriend, or it just might have been from a gang rape, for example. So a lot of our clients have a difficult time connecting with their children, understandably. Of course they love their children, but it's really hard for them to parent their children. And of course, many of these women are very young. So being young, having been in captivity, and the fact that the child is from the trafficker can be really damaging and difficult. It's not as much of an issue now, but forced abortion is a big issue, either through poisoning or beatings. I think beating is much more common than poisoning. And now, from what we're seeing with our clients, is that they've changed their tactics a bit, and they've gotten a little bit smarter, so they're force-feeding birth control pills so that they prevent pregnancy and they don't have their menstruations, so that they're able to work continuously. And that has its own consequences that can, once they escape the trafficking situation, their hormone levels are just going back. You know, they've been on a really high dosage of birth control pills, way above the FDA regulation, so they're taking 3 or 4 a day, and then they come off of it and they don't, you know, some of them don't menstruate for a long time, or some of them just go through really heavy bleeding. But some of it's also not pill related, so. And then of course, if the STD goes untreated for a really long time, it can lead to infertility. That we haven't seen because I haven't been here for, you know, long term to be able to see that. but it's definitely been documented. And then I think another interesting reproductive health issue for our clients is unplanned pregnancy after they've escaped their situation. We'd like to be very open with our clients, and they continue to be in relationships, and we try to prevent them from being abusive ones or for them to enter another abusive relationship. But a lot of women are in normal, healthy relationships, and of course it depends on the person. Some clients are very traumatized and very closed off, and they live in shelters and isolated, still live in isolation. And even women in shelter, they decide to embark on new relationships, and sometimes psychologically that's a great way for them to maybe forget things, or maybe they have healed, but you know, they're regular people going through regular relationships. And what we see a lot is that there's an interesting psychology. They desire to have children, and they desire to, you know, they want to move on with their lives. And so we have seen a lot of unplanned pregnancies or undesired pregnancies, but because of their religious implications or their cultural background, a lot of them don't think adoption or, you know, abortion is an option, which is really difficult when they don't have education, they don't have a career, they don't have stable housing. And to bring in more children to the world, it's been a huge issue. So I think that there's a lack of reproductive health education going on there, and a lack of available family planning services. And then one last issue that we see is that some of our victims are a little bit older, and they have children who are teenagers. And these teenagers often either have been left in the home country and just have been reunified with their parents. And so that brings on a whole host of other issues. They're going through puberty. They've been left alone, so they feel completely abandoned. They come to this new country. They may or may not understand what has happened to their mothers. And they, you know, they may act out in sexual ways too. So we see a lot of our teenage clients going through a lot of, and you know, it's really difficult for the parents to have a conversation about sex when they have been sex trafficking victims. Of course, it's difficult for any parent to have that conversation. But it's been a huge issue trying to, there's been a lot of pregnancies with our teenage clients. And then I'm going to go on and move on and talk about the mental health issues. As you can imagine, just like any DV victim or sexual violence victim, they show the same signs, but of course a lot of the times it's a lot more severe. So I think Andy briefly talked about it, but I mean, depression, disorientation, confusion, not remembering things, phobias, panic attacks, a lot of denial going on. That's just what Andy finished talking about. If you can imagine just having, the trafficking, it depends on what type of trafficking you've been through, but some women have never seen daylight and haven't even received middle school education in their home country. So just navigating the subway system is often very, very difficult. And so what I would like to stress, so I want to now talk about the challenges in addressing these health issues. Of course, first and foremost, there's not that many providers who are aware of trafficking and the extent of trafficking and the possibility that, you know, a trafficking victim might walk through their door. So I think all of our agencies are working hard to educate providers, social workers, medical providers. Emergency room doctors are especially important. A lot of our clients go through domestic violence-related care through the ER. And they're not necessarily seen as trafficking victims, but they'll have a really bad incident, and they might call the cops, and they might come into the ER as domestic violence victims. But it's, in that case, really important to ask just a few more questions and have some screening tools so that you can differentiate. Although there's a lot of overlap, you can differentiate between a domestic violence victim and a sex trafficking victim. Another challenge is, of course, before they receive immigration relief, which Hemi will talk a little bit more about, lack of insurance is a huge issue. We're a little bit luckier in New York, of course, because we have public health and public hospitals have HHC options. Some of the clinics like Planned Parenthood have sliding fee scale. And of course, I know Charles B. Wong has sliding fee scale. But the lack of insurance is certainly difficult. We have clients residing in New Jersey where access to insurance is a lot more limited. So that's been really difficult. Cultural and linguistic sensitivity. It's amazing how many providers in big hospitals don't speak Spanish. It's surprising. and then, of course, for obstetrics and gynecological care to be provided in the language would be very helpful. And of course, it usually helps that it's a female provider. Some clients don't care, but most of our clients do want female providers. Continuity of care is another issue. A lot of public hospitals or clinics, they will assign you to a person who is there that day. If you make an appointment, you can't usually make an appointment with one provider ongoing. So the issue is that even though they have notes and keep really good records of the prior visit, the doctor will most likely not read through them. And so then in that case, they might completely miss the fact that they were ever a trafficking victim if they weren't treated for a condition related to trafficking. And so they won't have that in mind. So, and then as a case manager, you might have to re-explain the situation. So it's I think it'd be really great if it was just one provider seeing the client continuously. It's not necessary, but it'd be very helpful. And then another thing is that there's a lot of pushback with case management. Our agency, I think, is one of the few agencies in the city that accompany clients to actual visits. The first OB-GYN appointment can be obviously very traumatizing for clients that have just escaped the trafficking situation. If you're getting an annual and you're getting a speculum inserted, that in and of itself can be very traumatizing. So it's really helpful. Of course, we ask for the client's consent before entering with them, and if they would like us to go with them either to just to the hospital or actually into the examination room, we're there for them. But there's been a lot of pushback, and part of it is that providers are doing their jobs and making sure that the client, you know, they're keeping confidentiality. But a lot of it is also they don't understand case manager's role. So right now we're speaking to Planned Parenthood about having a direct referral system where we can call them ahead of time, and then we can just arrange for the case manager to accompany the client. And then another issue is that, you know, and one big problem that I notice is that, oh, no, we have to refer them to a social worker. And I'll sit there and explain, I've identified myself as sanctuary staff, as a case manager, and they'll say no, but we would really like to do a full intake. And that can be really traumatizing for the client re-explaining our story. And I think a lot of it, even though part of it is them doing their job, a lot of it is that they have a morbid curiosity about what trafficking is. But if I'm telling them they're receiving all services from our organizations and she just really needs medical attention today, I felt a lot of pushback around that. So that's been really interesting. And then the last point that I would like to stress is that one of the challenges is that, like most sexual victims, sex trafficking victims present with physical conditions that might have physical reasonings and causes, but a lot of it might be psychosomatic. So it's related to their underlying mental health condition and the trauma that they've experienced. So general pelvic pain is something that's so difficult to treat. Or a lot of women complain about breast or nipple pain. They even have nipple discharge. And a lot of it is just assuring the clients, going through all the diagnostic tests and assuring them you don't have cancer, you know, you're not infertile. There's nothing wrong with you, but it's completely normal to feel like you're in constant pain because of the experiences you've been through. And if you really think about some of our clients, I don't want to generalize, but there are many of our clients see at least 5 to 10 clients a day. And if you consider those rapes, that's 5 to 10 rapes a day. And if they've been in captivity for 5 years, that's a lot. And it's obviously completely normal that they would feel pain in their body, not even just related to, you know, the pelvis area. So that's something that we have to constantly assure our clients and explain to medical providers as well, that, you know, at the end of the day, there not might be something medically wrong, but, you know, let's just make sure that they're getting counseling and their mental health needs are getting, you know, that they're on a path to a more holistic recovery so that at the end of the day, they feel physically better.
We want to say thank you for everybody for coming out and for spending the day with us. Just wanted to wrap things up and just say just a few quick things before you go. First of all, we definitely want to thank you for coming and thank all our speakers for providing us with such interesting information and so much information for us that I hope that we all take back to share as resources with our coworkers and be able to start dialogues in our own offices and see how we can go about making changes or just seeing how much better that things are going out in the community, that people are starting to think about ways that we can definitely work together and make significant strides in the healthcare community. All right. Thank you very much for coming.
Happy holidays.